Hello students, so last time we had discussed different multi-parameter models including multinomial distribution and normal mu sigma square model. We had also briefly discussed how to derive the posterior distribution of mu and sigma square using the non-informative prior. So let us discuss the same in details. So suppose xi's are IID random variables following normal distribution with parameters mu and sigma square. So this will be the joint distribution of xi's. Now suppose that the joint prior distribution of mu and sigma square is 1 by sigma square. Now notice that this joint distribution arises from the fact that the conditional prior distribution of mu given sigma square is 1 by sigma square and the prior distribution of sigma square is simply 1. So if we look at it like this, then this becomes a non-informative prior. One more point of interest about this prior is that even if you make a transformation from sigma square to 1 by sigma square, so suppose we call eta as 1 by sigma square, still the prior distribution will not change, it will be the same. So for example, pi of mu and eta, where eta is 1 by sigma square, will be again 1 by eta square. So in that sense, this distribution is a non-informative prior distribution. We will discuss more about the prior, non-informative prior, flat prior, vague prior, constant prior, Jeffrey's prior, conjugate prior. So all these are different types of prior distributions and their features. So in the next week, we will have a separate video on this. So let us now proceed. So let us consider the joint distribution of xi's and mu and sigma square. So it will be like this. This 1 by sigma square will be multiplied by the joint distribution of xi's. So we will have sigma square raised to, we had n by 2. Now this plus 1 will be because of this 1 by sigma square. The rest of the terms are as they were. Now we want to find the posterior distribution of mu and sigma square. So first we will need the joint distribution of xi's only. So to find that, we will integrate out this joint distribution of xi's and mu sigma square with respect to mu and then with respect to sigma square. So let us see how we can find out. So the joint distribution of xi's and sigma square is integration of this joint distribution with respect to mu. Now if you realize, in this joint distribution only one term is there which contains the variable mu. So this is the term which contains mu. So the rest of the terms are free from mu, so they can be kept aside the integration. And so we have this. We have also splitted the summation xi minus x bar, summation xi minus mu whole square into these two terms for our convenience. So the first term is summation xi minus x bar whole square plus n times x bar minus mu whole square. So this will help us in the further calculations. So let us consider the integration with respect to mu. So here this term needs to be integrated out. So notice that this is part of a PDF of normal distribution with mean x bar and variance sigma square by n. So using the fact that the density function will integrate to 1, the integration of this will be root 2 pi into root of sigma square by n. So upon simplification of this and this, we will get this term. So this term will be 1 upon sigma square raised to n by 2 plus 1 was there, and now this is sigma square raised to half. So plus 1 minus half, so I will have plus half. So I will have 1 upon sigma square raised to n by 2 plus half, which can further be written as n plus 1 whole upon 2. Then similarly, here we had 2 pi raised to n by 2 and here we have half. So this will be 2 pi raised to n by 2 minus half. So that will be n minus 1 whole upon 2. And this root n will remain here as it is. And this exponential term, that is the term from here, the first term, this term will remain as it is. So this is the joint distribution of xi's and sigma square. Now let us integrate out sigma square. So to integrate out sigma square, we will make a substitution as 1 by sigma square is equal to u. So the derivative will be minus 1 by u square du. So finally the joint distribution of xi will be like this. 1 by root n from here will be as it is. Then 1 upon 2 pi raised to n minus 1 by 2 will be as it is. And now this term sigma square raised to 1 upon sigma square raised to n plus 1 by 2. So we will that will become u raised to n plus 1 by 2 like this here. And then e raised to minus n minus 1 s square upon 2 sigma square will become this. And the derivative will come from here, which is u raised to minus 2 du. So as a result, we have u raised to n by 2 minus 3 by 2 and the exponential term. Now, compare this with the gamma function. So this will be gamma of n minus 1 upon 2. Notice that this is n by 2 minus 3 by 2. So we will compare this with lambda minus 1 so that we get lambda is equal to n minus 1 by 2. So this will be gamma lambda upon the coefficient of u raised to lambda. So gamma n minus 1 by 2 upon n minus 1 s square by 2 raised to n minus 1 by 2. So this 2 raised to n minus 1 by 2 and this 2 raised to n minus 1 by 2, they cancel each other. So what is left is pi raised to n minus 1 by 2. And here again n minus 1 s square raised to n minus 1 by 2. So we can put this pi here. So finally we get the joint distribution of xi as 1 upon root n gamma of n minus 1 by 2 upon n minus 1 s square pi raised to n minus 1 by 2. So now n minus 1 s square is summation xi minus x bar whole square. So finally the joint distribution of xi will be like this. So this is nothing but the prior predictive distribution of the sample, a random sample of size n from normal distribution with mean mu and variance sigma square with non-informative prior for mu and sigma square. So this will be the prior predictive distribution. To have a better understanding, you can consider the case of n is equal to 2. So when n is equal to 2, this will be 1 upon root 2. This will be gamma of 2 minus 1 upon half, means gamma of half means root pi, and this will be pi raised to half, so root pi again. So this root pi and this root pi, they are going to cancel each other, and this summation will contain only two terms. So the first term will be x1 minus x bar whole square, the second term will be x2 minus x bar whole square, and this raised to half. So the joint distribution of xi for n is equal to 2 is very simple. It is 1 upon root 2 into 1 upon summation x1, sorry, 1 upon root 2 into 1 upon x1 plus x1 minus x bar whole square plus x2 minus x bar whole square. Now let us consider the computation of posterior distribution of mu and sigma square. So as we know, the posterior distribution will be equal to this. So let us look at the ratio of the two densities carefully. This will be sigma square raised to minus n plus 2 by 2. Recall that the joint distribution of xi and mu sigma square was sigma square raised to minus n by 2 plus 1. So n by 2 plus 1 you will write as n plus 2 upon 2. Then 2 pi raised to minus n by 2, and this exponential term was there. Now the distribution of xi is 1 upon root n gamma n minus 1 by 2 pi n minus 1 s square raised to minus n minus 1 by 2. Now notice that there is only one term which contains mu, this exponential term, and this term looks like it is a part of normal PDF with mean x bar and variance sigma square by n. So because the final aim is to obtain the joint posterior distribution of mu and sigma square, we can adjust the joint posterior distribution as conditional posterior distribution of mu given sigma square multiplied by the marginal posterior distribution of sigma square given x. So if we adjust this term such that the first term itself becomes a perfect normal density, then the rest of the term automatically will be the marginal posterior distribution of sigma square. Now why we are talking about conditional posterior and marginal posterior. So one interesting thing which you can note easily here is that even if we consider the terms containing mu, sigma square is already present there. But when you consider the terms containing sigma square, there are some terms which contain only sigma square and do not contain mu. So this indirectly tells us that the distribution of mu depends on sigma square, but distribution of sigma square doesn't depend directly on mu. So the joint distribution can be written as, in this case, the conditional distribution of mu given sigma square and multiplied by the marginal distribution of sigma square. So let us treat this as a part of conditional posterior distribution of mu given sigma square. So if we multiply it by root n times root n upon sigma root 2 pi, this becomes a perfect normal density function. So let us multiply this exponential term by root n upon sigma root 2 pi. So this is simply the conditional posterior distribution of mu given sigma square. Now let us see what remains. So what we have done is, in the denominator we have sigma, means in the denominator we have sigma square raised to half. So now here we had sigma square raised to minus n by 2 plus 1, means sigma square raised to minus n plus 2 by 2. So in the numerator we had, means here I have taken sigma square raised to half. So what will remain is sigma square raised to minus n plus 1 by 2 in the numerator, right? See here, this sigma square raised to half in the denominator will, if we take it to the numerator, it will be sigma square raised to minus half. So now we had sigma square raised to minus n plus 2 upon 2. So from that I have taken away half. So what remains will be n plus 1 by 2. Okay, so I hope you are understanding this. So now let us consider the powers of 2. So here I had 2 raised to minus n by 2. So 2 raised to minus n by 2, from that I have taken 2 raised to minus half here I have taken. So what will remain is 2 raised to minus n minus 1 by 2. So 2's power we have adjusted. Now let us look at the pi. So now here I had pi raised to minus n by 2 and here I have pi raised to minus n minus 1 by 2. So what remains will be pi raised to minus minus half, means pi raised to half, means root pi. So root pi was there in the denominator, we have kept it as it is here. So pi, we don't need to adjust any powers of pi. Okay, so now what are the terms which are remaining? So this term remains. So gamma n minus 1 by 2, it comes here. Then this term, n minus 1 a square raised to minus n minus 1 by 2. So we have minus power in the denominator, so it will go to the numerator and it will be simply n minus 1 a square raised to n minus 1 whole upon 2. And this exponential term, this will appear here as it is. So can we adjust this further? So this 2 raised to minus n minus 1 by 2 can be merged with this. So this will be n minus 1 a square upon 2. So see, this can be rewritten as n minus 1 a square by 2 raised to n minus 1 by 2. This term is nothing but pi mu given sigma square and x. Then 1 upon gamma of n minus 1 by 2 and sigma square raised to minus n minus 1 by 2 plus 1 into, I'm sorry, I forgot to write the exponential term here, but this exponential term will be here as well. So this should be carried here. So the exponential term will appear here. It will be e raised to minus n minus 1 a square by 2 sigma square. So notice that all this is nothing but the PDF of inverse gamma distribution with parameters or shape as n minus 1, shape as n minus 1 by 2 and scale rate as n minus 1 a square by 2. Some authors also refer this as inverse chi-square distribution, but notice that it is not exactly same as inverse chi-square distribution, but instead it is scaled inverse chi-square distribution. So instead of referring it as scaled inverse chi-squared, I prefer to call it as inverse gamma distribution, which we have already studied last year. So thus, the joint posterior distribution of mu and sigma square, assuming a non-informative prior for mu sigma square, is the product of normal PDF and inverse gamma PDF. What will happen if we assume a normal prior distribution for mu given sigma square and an inverse gamma distribution as a prior for sigma square? What will happen? So that is another point of interest. Let us see, if we start with such a prior, do we get the posterior also as a product of normal and inverse gamma densities? So we will see that in the next lecture.